Recorded Books and One Click Digital present Saving Simon, How a Rescue Donkey Taught Me the Meaning of Compassion by Jon Katz. Narrated by Tom Stechschulte.
Part 1. Saving Simon. Prologue. The Raid. It was Mackenzie Barrett, the animal control officer's daughter, who named him Simon. A name from the Bible, she said, and she thought if she named the donkey Simon, he would be blessed and never be hurt again. A New York State police trooper had come by earlier in the day, climbed the hill nearby with his binoculars, sketched out a map of the donkey's enclosure, he wasn't sure what to call it, it was so small, and distributed copies to everyone assisting with the raid. The other troopers, the vet, the local animal control officer, the driver of the trailer that would take Simon away, dead or alive. It was difficult to tell through the binoculars. He thought it might already be too late. The property had a farmhouse and a large barn that fronted the north side of the road. Between the house and the old barn, a dirt road, little more than a path at some points, wound back through a meadow and a stand of pine trees, then alongside a small wire mesh enclosure. The structure, completely out of sight from the road, sheltered by brush and trees, was small. The fences, sturdy. Even standing by the farmhouse, no one would have imagined it was there. It was probably built for pigs or a couple of goats, animals that needed strong fences and barriers to keep them contained in a small pen. It was ugly and primitive. A mud path surrounded by heavy mesh fence. Two or three pallets stood up to form a V, low enough for a pig or some chickens to get inside. Through his binoculars, the trooper had seen that the donkey was lying down with his head under the pallet, perhaps seeking shelter from the rain, perhaps to die. From the slime and muck that coated the creature's side, the trooper saw he had been lying there a long time. His skin was black. They call it rain rot, an animal's skin dying, turning black from lying in the rain and cold for weeks or months and never being dry. The pallet was an island in a sea of mud, waste, and bits of rotted wood and fence post. The donkey was sunk, stuck, really, in the mud up to his shoulders. He was almost buried in his own manure. The smell was awful, the stench reaching out across the meadow into the wind. The trooper estimated the pen was 10 feet by 10 feet, barely big enough to accommodate the donkey's prone body. If he could stand, the donkey would barely be able to turn around. But he was absolutely still. Even from the distance, the trooper could see the awful condition of the animal's legs and coat, the skeletal ribs protruding. He couldn't see any sign of the stomach rising or falling. The animal's home was more like a place to dump garbage or waste rather than a shelter. At 10 p.m., the trooper was finally at the pen, dreading what he would find. He had fretted about it all day, pushing paperwork, nudging the bureaucracy along, arguing it was worth the time and expense, even though his superiors thought there were more pressing issues. As the troopers and the animal control officer approached the gate, they stopped. They were hardened and experienced. They had seen a lot, but never anything like this. The animal control officer shook her head. "My God," she said. "Why didn't whoever owns him just shoot him?" One of the young troopers rushed over to the brush and vomited. The donkey was covered with lice and tracked with the bite marks of rats. One of the troopers asked the vet how old the donkey was. "There's no way to be sure. I'll have to see him in the light. But I'd guess about 15 years, the vet replied. He fell silent, shifted his big bag from one shoulder to the other, then said, "Let's get in there." Rats were spotted at the edge of the field, staring, waiting. A sheriff's deputy put his hand on his gun, but another officer touched his arm, shaking his head. Even rats were not grounds to shoot. He leaned over and tossed a rock out toward the rats, but they did not move. Another deputy walked up with a light on a tripod stand and a small portable generator. He fired up the generator, and the pen was flooded with white light. The troopers, vet, and animal control officer all gathered around the donkey, who had not moved nor made a sound. The vet placed the flat metal disc of his stethoscope on the donkey's neck. "Well, he's alive," he said, "barely. Let's get the pallet off of him." They stood up and shifted the wooden structure away from the donkey's head and shined their flashlights on his face. There was a moment of stunned silence. Then some of the men tied handkerchiefs over their noses, and everybody got to work. The vet placed the big canvas bag down in the mud, taking out syringes, vials, sponges, painkillers, wrenches and clamps for teeth pulling, vitamins and energy boosters, balm and ointments for the skin, powder for the lice, gauze patches for the rat bites, antibiotics for the oozing eyes. What to treat first? He would need everything he had. He went to work quickly. The troopers were used to standing and watching and waiting. It was a big part of the job. They gathered in a circle behind the vet, handing him towels and blankets, hand wipes and tools, pointing their flashlights where he asked. Some of the work he could do later, after they transported the donkey to the animal control officer's farm a few towns over. That was the plan. If Simon was still alive, they would stabilize him and get him up and over to the farm. There was a barn there with some empty stalls. They could get a better look at him in the morning. As the vet kneeled over the donkey, he said, "This is the worst state I have ever seen an animal in 20 years of practice." He was surprised to see his own tears falling on his bag, on his bottles and wraps. It rarely happened, but he told himself to suck it up and get to work. "Lord," he thought, "I didn't ever want to see this." But wasn't it why he had become a vet? Wasn't it the point? Sometimes he thought, "I'm ashamed to be a human." He had little time. The animal's pulse and heartbeat were fading quickly. The vet had seen that the donkey's hooves were sticking out like wings. It had been so long since they were trimmed. "He must have been walking on his ankles," he said. "He can't walk that way to the trailer. I have to cut the hooves off right now." He stood, ran over to his truck, and pulled out a battery-charged buzzsaw. He reached for the painkillers and a sedative. He'd have to put the donkey out for a bit. The pain must be horrible. But if he didn't trim his hooves, he would never make it to the trailer. Before he started, he pulled open the donkey's mouth. Simon's right eye was sticking out of the mud, open, staring at him through the film and ooze. The vet looked at his jaw, then up at the trooper. "I have to pull them now. There's a massive infection in there. I have to sedate him. I won't knock him out because we won't be able to get him up. I'll get him sleepy, poor guy. But he's going to feel this." And he went to work. "Will he make it?" asked one of the troopers. "I don't know," said the vet. "A part of me thinks he ought not to make it. That would give him some peace." "No," said the animal control officer, leaning over, putting her arm on the vet's shoulder. "I think I may have found a home for him. A guy has two donkeys, a writer. He said he'd come take a look in the morning, if we can get him to my house. Let's try it. Let's give him a shot." The vet looked up at her, nodded. He opened Simon's jaws and put a clamp inside to keep them open. They did not know a donkey could scream. He would have died, except for the child who lived in the farmhouse. The small boy came quietly every night, very late. Simon could have seen his face clearly in the moonlight if he had been watching for him, but mostly he became aware of him as he approached the fence, so softly in his bare feet, even in the cold, whispering quietly for Simon to be still, and tossing some hay over the fence toward the donkey's head. At first, the boy could reach over the fence and hold some hay out for Simon to grasp, but in recent days, Simon was lying on his side, unable to move or stand up, and the boy threw the hay as near to Simon's head as he could. "I'm sorry," the boy would say, sometimes crying. "This is all that I can give you. I can't do any more." He would look to see if the donkey were still alive, toss the hay, then as quickly as he had come, he was gone, vanished into the meadows behind the farmhouse. From the first, Simon loved the boy, as donkeys so dearly love their human children. They protect them, watch for them, bray softly for them, love giving them rides on their backs and hanging around them. The spirits of children are so like the spirits of donkeys, small and good and open, curious and independent. The boy had always sensed that Simon needed human attention. For all the hard things that came from people, donkeys never take attention for granted. They need the touch of people, the safety and the tenderness of children. It heals them, and they heal in return. Simon was still. The vet was finishing his work, and the animal control officer had begun to think about Simon's future. "We need to try. That writer texted again. He has a big barn and lots of pasture. He loves animals, and he's stubborn like a donkey. They'll get along." And then, unimaginably, just a few minutes later, Simon was moving, his instincts returning, fighting to live. The animal control officer, she had long yellow hair, the kind donkeys love to nibble on, and the men were all shouting at him, "Simon, get up! Get up! You're okay now! We're here to take you away!" They were excited, and their excitement was being transmitted to him. The vet kept yelling that his pulse was dropping. He was in shock. They forced open his swollen jaws again and squirted liquid into his stomach through a tube. They put a needle in his neck and attached it to a plastic bottle hanging on a stand. "Eat, Simon," they begged. "Eat it. Get up. Move. Please move." Simon started at the radio's crackling. In numbing pain, he was blinded by the bright and flashing lights and confused by the noise. He seemed dizzy, lightheaded, and struggling. He seemed to focus on one person, the woman with the blonde hair. She had connected with him. It was as if she grounded him, helped him make sense of the chaos and pain. They made their way slowly down the drive, and then the procession suddenly stopped. Across from the farmhouse, his hands folded across his chest, his head bowed, the farmer stood waiting. The troopers and the others stopped to look at him. Some were angry. It showed on their faces. Others were bewildered, trying to comprehend. The farmer looked exhausted, downcast. He was in jeans, wearing heavy boots and a red flannel shirt. He couldn't lift his eyes to look at Simon. The troopers went over to him, said something, handed him some paper. "I'm sorry," said the farmer, still looking down. "Things got away from me. After a while, I just couldn't bear to go back there. I couldn't stand to see it." The troopers said nothing. They just stared back at him. Walking back toward Simon, one trooper turned to the other and said, "I've seen it before. They just can't ask for help, can't admit when they're so far down." The other trooper nodded. They shined their powerful flashlights into the darkness. The bushes stirred, and the boy came out in his pajamas, barefoot in the mud and cold. The boy was short, thin, about 10 years old, a mop of brown hair hanging over his face. His eyes were red and moist. "What are you doing in there, son?" asked one of the troopers. The boy edged forward toward Simon, and the trooper moved to stop him. The animal control officer waved the trooper back and took the boy's hand. She leaned over and whispered something in his ear, tousled his hair. "You're the one who called." It was a statement, not a question. "Don't worry," said the woman. "It's our secret. Do you want to say goodbye?" The boy looked up at her and Simon and nodded. "Please," he said, looking anxiously back at the farmhouse. Simon's ears went up. He brayed softly. Even the animals seemed startled by the weak, squeaky sound, more fitting for a mouse than a donkey. The boy looked at Simon, then at the troopers. "My dad is a good man," he told the big sergeant. "It's just hard now." The sergeant nodded. Simon seemed so at ease with the boy that the animal control officer turned over the reins to the child. The boy, smiling now, took the lead and called out to Simon, "Come on, let's go." And the procession resumed. He led Simon down the path and onto the road and right up into the trailer. Although it took Simon a long time to get up the ramp on his painful and unsteady legs. When he did, helped along by half a dozen pairs of strong arms, the boy was waiting for him, holding a leaf of hay. Simon stood for a bit, taking the hay into his mouth, eager for its rich and warm taste, even with his painful gums and swollen jaw. The boy reached up and hugged Simon, kissing him on the nose. Simon watched him walk down the trailer ramp. He turned to follow, but he couldn't, restrained now by gates and ropes tied to rings in the corners of the trailer. The boy turned and waved, then ran off. Simon's plaintive bray echoed off the trailer walls and out into the meadow and over that small and awful place that had been his home, the home he would never see again. Simon was tied firmly to the trailer sides, but it bumped over dirt roads and wobbled back and forth, and each bump and turn was like a bolt of lightning up his legs, into his jaw. They stood alongside him, talking to him, rubbing salve onto his wounds, telling him it would be okay. Soon the trailer came to a new place. Simon was led off to a large red barn. He heard horses neighing to him from the pasture beyond. He felt the jabs of more needles, then, drained and exhausted, he collapsed onto a bed of straw. They worked through the night to save him. They finished sawing the wings off of his feet. They pulled half of his teeth, the infected ones, from his jaw. He was bathed in medicines to heal the sores. Powders were applied to kill the lice and fleas. They put braces on his legs to hold them, drops in his eyes to clear them, gauze poultices to reduce the swelling in his mouth. Wounds were wrapped and medicines administered to heal the rat bites. The rain rot, his blackened skin, would take months to heal. Simon's legs would never be completely straight, but with luck, he might be able to walk and move around. Outside, the troopers sat in their cars, their engines idling, drinking their coffee, passing updates back and forth. People often get wrapped up in the fates of animals, and these men were no exception. They were invested in saving this beat-up old donkey, left for dead in his pen, even though none of them was likely to ever see him again. That was the nature of their work. "Will he make it?" one asked. "You have to admire him," said another. "He never quit. Think what it must have taken to stay alive in that hell hole." By the late morning, the troopers had left and Simon was alone again. He looked around. He was under shelter, but the gates were open, and next to him was a small field filled with shrubs. It was early spring and the grass had started to come up. Simon staggered over to it, leaned his head down, and seemed to almost drink up the moist, fresh grass, the lifeblood of the donkey. Then he lay down. It was quiet. The birds were singing. Cars and trucks whizzed down a busy highway. He listened to the dogs barking nearby, was aware of horses in a pasture up the hill. There was hay all around him and a bed of straw to lie on. His eyes were clearing. He could see again. A few feet down the hill, there was a creek with fresh water, and he gathered himself to get down to it, to drink greedily and for a long time. His stomach ached, but he was not really hungry. There was nothing familiar around him. He brayed, calling out to the boy. But he was not there. He did not come. Chapter 1. My First Donkey. I ought to explain why it was that the police thought I might take a dying donkey onto my farm, an unusual thing for a city boy like me, who for most of his life thought that donkeys lived only in India or Spain. I asked the animal control officer how many people they had asked to consider taking Simon, wondering how I had come to her attention and that of the New York State Police. "Just you," she said. "Oh," I said in one of those mind-altering moments when you get a glimpse of how others might see you. "We knew you had some donkeys and loved them," she said. "I read your books." I'm an author and photographer who owns a farm in upstate New York. I live there with my wife, Maria, and numerous animals. My life has never proceeded in straight lines. Zigs and zags are more my style. If my life on a farm is characterized by any one idea, it would be this: one thing leads to another. And it was Carol that led in zigs and zags to Simon. I believe the first donkey I ever laid eyes on was wearing a straw hat and hee-hawing at Elmer Fudd on a Saturday morning cartoon. I remember the donkey had enormous teeth and was rather loud and goofy. I never saw a real donkey until I was nearly 50 years old. I had taken my border collie out to a sheep farm in Pennsylvania to learn how to herd sheep. The experience transformed me in many ways. I decided to buy my own farm. I began writing about dogs, and I encountered a donkey who was to alter the nature of my life. Carol was nearly 20 years old when I met her. She was living in a small corral. Like many donkeys, Carol seemed an afterthought, a misfit. Donkeys come to farms for all kinds of reasons. Somebody might trade a donkey for an old horse or for some hay. A farmer might come across one and take pity on it, or suspect it might be useful down the road. Sometimes donkeys luck out and end up on rich horse farms, keeping horses company, getting to eat the good hay and grain, and are even quartered indoors in heated stalls. But that is not the fate of most donkeys. Donkeys have lived with humans as long as or longer than dogs have, but donkeys haven't figured out how to worm their way into human hearts quite so well. Their history and general treatment don't speak well of the generosity and mercy of human beings. The farmer couldn't even quite remember how Carol had ended up with him, but she had been in that corral every day for the 16 years that he had owned her. Once in a while, he tossed some hay over the fence and filled up the rusty bathtub with fresh water, but mostly Carol survived off of brush and bark, pooled rainwater and water from a small muddy stream that ran through her corral. Twice a year, a farrier came to trim her hooves. The farmer was busy, and he conceded that most of the time he forgot about Carol. Farm animals are not pets. They're pretty hardy. Donkeys are especially hardy and can go far on very little. The thought of Carol alone for years in that tiny patch of woods haunted me, offering some of the first stirrings of an emotional notion of compassion. But even then, my response to her was to bring some apples whenever I visited the farm. It didn't go much deeper than that. I was distracted, busy. I had a kid, other worries. The life of a donkey seemed very remote to me. Carol was not good-natured or accepting, and she did not wish to have her hooves trimmed. After a while, the battered farrier just gave her a drugged apple before going to work. She still managed to bite and kick him at least once every time. The farmer told me this by way of cautioning me to be careful around her. "She has sweet eyes," he said, "but she is not sweet." Maybe I thought that was why he had left her alone in that corral all these years. Carol's corral was right next to the big pasture where I was learning to herd sheep with my dog, and I would see her staring at me. It unnerved me. She seemed to be trying to tell me something. But since I had never come near a real donkey in my life, I had no idea what it was she might be saying. I felt bad for her, in the way middle-class people who grew up in cities feel bad for animals who live their natural lives out in the real world. We just can't help but project feelings into their heads. I just assumed she was hungry, and she seemed quite lonely all by herself in that corral, staring at me. The first time I brought her apples, I walked over to the corral, my pockets stuffed with some big red juicy ones. Carol leaned over the fence, grabbed the first apple, and nearly my thumb with it, and crunched it judiciously and hungrily. My dog was standing back, staring at Carol, trying to keep an eye on the sheep who were grazing nearby. I reached for another apple, but Carol was not willing to be patient. She walked right through the fence, dragging wire and fence posts behind her, put her ears down, and charged my terrified dog, who took off toward the other side of the pasture. The sheep needed no invitation to leave, and they took off in the other direction. Carol then turned to me, ripped the apple out of my pocket, and began nosing my other pockets for more. "Hey, hey," I said, not sure what commands to give a donkey. I was shocked to realize she could have walked through the fence any day of those 16 years she had spent there had she chosen to. It was my first real demonstration of donkey thinking. The first rule of the donkey ethos: everything is their idea. It took a while for the irritated farmer to get Carol back inside. A loaf of bread did it, and he warned me in no uncertain terms to leave her alone. I couldn't do that, of course. Every time I came herding, I brought apples and carrots. I would climb into her corral with the treats, so she would have no reason to bust out. There are some people who are deeply drawn into the rescue of animals. I am not one. I think in some ways animal rescue is too intense for me, too difficult. Perhaps that's one reason I love happy, healthy, well-bred working dogs. I love to do things with them. I love the way they enter my life easily and come along with me. But I fell in love with Carol, this grumpy, independent creature. I worried about her. I wanted to help her. It did something for me, something selfish, to treat her well. It fed something inside of me. In her own way, she was quite affectionate with me. She loved it when I rubbed the inside of her ears or tickled the sides of her nose. She wouldn't let me brush her, and if I didn't have an apple, she would lower her head and butt me in the side or rear end. Carol made no pretense about our relationship. She wanted the apples, and if she felt like it, she might allow me to show her some affection, or not. Donkeys cannot be bought or bribed, only appeased. And Carol, well, she was not very nice. She wouldn't have fit into one of those cute donkey tales in cartoons and movies. Sometimes you had to like the idea of her more than Carol herself. This was perhaps the first inkling I had about the vagaries of compassion. We tend to feel it for people and animals we like. It's hard to feel it for people and animals we don't like. Whenever I was out herding, Carol would come over to the fence and hang her head on the outside, her ears turning like radar scanners, eyeing me soulfully with her big brown eyes. Somehow, it seemed as if I were her human and she was my donkey, even though my home at the time was in suburban New Jersey, where donkeys played no part in the life of anyone. A year or so after I met Carol, I bought a farm in upstate New York. I called it Bedlam Farm. And I bought some of the sheep I had been working with. The farmer hired somebody with a trailer to drive them up to me. If I had never met a donkey before Carol, I also had never set foot on a farm before in my life. I was raised in Providence, Rhode Island, and had lived in New York City, Dallas, Boston, Washington, and Baltimore before moving to New Jersey. The farm would, in my mind, become a laboratory for my newfound passion to write about dogs, animals, and rural life. Bedlam Farm consisted of 90 acres, a Civil War-era farmhouse, four barns, and large areas of fenced-in pasture. It was a good place for sheep and a paradise for donkeys, although I had no plans to acquire any. I had heard from farmers that donkeys were wonderful guard animals and would keep coyotes and predators away from sheep. But I had my hands full just trying to survive on my new farm. When the trailer of sheep arrived, the driver backed it into the pasture and opened the gates. The first creature out was Carol, who looked around disdainfully, snorted, kicked one of the sheep away from her, and put her nose in my pocket. The driver handed me a note from the farmer, which read, "Here is Carol. You love her so much, you can feed her." So began my life with Carol. She was, from the first, the most imperious creature I had ever met, human or animal. In hot summers, she loved to hang out in the big shady barn. She could barely believe her good fortune, having acres of pasture to wander and all the grass and fresh water she might want. Carol was an older donkey, and she had lived outdoors for years without shelter or good nutritious food. I saw her limping and had a large animal vet come and check her out. Carol did not wish to be examined. She butted the vet into the wall, tried to bite him, and nearly kicked him through the window. We got a halter on her and cross-tied her to the sides of the barn. She had a laundry list of ailments, from foundering, a painful wasting disease of the hooves, to swollen joints and gums. She was, the vet said, in great pain, and he gave her some shots and handed me a bunch of long needles to stick in her butt later in the day. Then he left. That night, when I went out to administer the medications, I got another major lesson in donkey thinking. They read intentions. When I came out to give Carol an apple, she was standing by the gate, meek as a kitten. If I came out with some needles or medicines in my pocket, she was off and running. That night, it was minus 20 degrees Fahrenheit, and a stubborn human and a stubborn donkey had an epic confrontation on my farm's hilly pasture. Carol took off in a blinding storm, hobbling and stumbling up a hill as my border collie, Rose, and I gave chase. I caught her an hour later on the top of the hill and stuck the needle in her butt while she dragged me all the way back down the hill. I got frostbite in three fingers that night. I learned that if you want to give a donkey a needle, get her in a small stall with a grain bucket, hide the needle out of sight, and then stick her when her mouth is full. Despite all her ailments, she kept giving me donkey lessons. One was the gait lesson. You can't just have a normal gait with a donkey. I had a chain that hung on my gate, and when you closed it, you wrapped the chain around the gatepost and it held fast. Carol loved to open gates and doors and windows. It was child's play for her. It took me a while to figure it out, but she would watch me latch the gate. Then she would lean over the fence and unwrap the chain, and the gate would swing open. Twice I came home to find that the gate was open, and so was the back door of the farmhouse. The knob was fun for her to grab and twist. Carol would get into the kitchen, open the cabinets, and munch on bread and cereal. And it was not simple to get her out of the kitchen either, no matter how loudly I would stomp my feet and yell. The only thing that drove her out was when I banged some pans together, startling her. Donkeys don't like loud sounds. Carol pretty much went where she pleased until I spent some serious money on latches that could not be opened from the inside. Still, Carol taught me much about love, or the very special ways in which donkeys love. Carol's hooves and health were stabilized for a while with vitamins, special grain, leg wraps, daily shots, administered bravely by me, painkillers, and the best hay. That winter, there was too much ice and snow for her to make it up to the hill, her favorite spot for avoiding me, so we really got to know each other. I had to go into the barn every night to give Carol all of her many medicines and wraps, and that took the better part of an hour. I worked out a deal with her. If I brought a bucket of grain or oats or something wonderful to eat, she would become surprisingly tolerant of my sticking needles into her and forcing pills down her big, smelly mouth. If I didn't, the process was war from beginning to end. It wasn't that she was bribable, she was not. But as a donkey who had lived off of grass, the bark of trees, and old hay, she seemed to consider it a good deal to get her oats in exchange for some intrusive prodding and poking. I like to think she came to trust me, but I'll also admit I bought a lot of good grain. Carol loved to eat, sniffing her food, picking it up in small amounts, chewing it deliberately, savoring each morsel. What was a needle in the face of all that? I made another surprising discovery. Carol loved music, and, more than anything, she loved Willie Nelson. I like Willie Nelson, too, and I discovered this shared passion when I brought a boombox into the barn with me to play while I was sorting through Carol's large bucket of pills and treatments. When I played Georgia on my mind, Carol's lip quivered. This is how donkeys show contentment, and her eyes closed, and she just seemed calm and serene. I came to love those moments. The big barn creaking in the wind, the barn cats skittering around the hay bales, Willie Nelson's gravelly but soothing voice echoing off the big old rafters in the roof. The music connected us somehow. It got to Carol, reached some unfathomable part of her. I got some greatest hits albums. She especially loved Good Hearted Woman, Mama Don't Let Your Babies Grow Up to Be Cowboys, and Help Me Make It Through the Night. Those hours in the barn became special to both of us. She would listen to Willie Nelson, who would put her into a mellow and dreamy state, and I would chew my granola bar. I thought we should be eating oats together. And those sessions became sweet, calm, and healing for both of us. Carol grew stronger and heartier, and I think she looked forward to our evenings as much as I did. Donkey bonding, I guess you'd call it. After a while, I began talking to her, and she seemed to be listening to me. I came to admire Carol for her integrity, her independence, and, eventually, the affection she would show me, leaning against me, letting me brush and stroke her forehead. Carol started to matter to me. She wasn't just an animal I was taking care of. We had connected in a deep way, a way I hadn't experienced before. It was different from what I'd had with dogs or other pets. It felt like something old, almost mystical. A few months after Carol came to my farm, I got a telephone call from a woman who said she had driven by the farm and observed Carol. She wanted to tell me, she said, that Carol was troubled, that she did not know she was a donkey. She was not in touch with her donkiness. This was a bit of a shock to me. It was not something I had thought much about, yet it did click. Carol had spent most of her life alone in that farm corral in Pennsylvania. She may not have ever seen another donkey. Who, I asked the woman, might you be? I am a Jewish donkey spiritualist, said the woman, introducing herself as Pat Freund. She bred and raised.
We hope you enjoyed this preview. To continue listening to this audiobook on Google Play Books, use the link in the video description.